Hello everyone. So I'll be starting the webinar now. So I welcome you all to this webinar on elevated road corridors with span and wing construction. So for superstructure construction. So here, this is Akshay Magar, structural engineer here at MIDAS IT. So we'll be starting this webinar with respect to today's innovative technology in case of bridge construction. So I'll just begin my presentation now. Yeah. So coming to my webinar contents for today. So we'll be going through the introduction. So we'll be looking at what basically is the span and wing construction about, its construction methodology. And we'll be having a quick introduction about the type of modelings. So in case the basic, this webinar is divided into two parts basically. So in one part, we'll be discussing about the longitudinal analysis, in which we'll be seeing about the modeling philosophy that would be adopted. Then we'll be seeing how the section, the complete white box girder section could be defined into the program. Then we'll be seeing about the modeling of your concrete spine, which is pre-stressed, the segmental pre-stressed spine, which would be defined into the program. Then we'll be looking after the material properties definition for the concrete and the reinforcement and the pre-stressing tendons, which would be defined in the program. Then again, next comes is the major important is your time-dependent material properties consideration. So that could also be defined into the program. Then we'll be talking about the segmental construction sequence of specifically for the spine and wing. So which is very most important in case of such structures. So I will be one by one discussing about the methodology, the general methodology it is being adopted and how that could be simulated into MIDAS. Then we'll be talking about the pre-stress load application and the temperature loads, which is again the major important loading on such structures. Then we'll look for the ULS and the SRS checks, how this could be done in the program. So I hope everyone is able to hear my voice clearly and the screen is visible. So if you have any questions in between regarding this, you can just let me know so that I can stop at that point and can be resolved. Okay, so let me move it forward. Yeah. So with the introduction, I'll just start with the introduction now. Yeah, so coming to the spine and wing construction, so basically it is a structural system in which all your superstructure elemental superstructure is resting on a single central verge pier. So basically it consists of your Hammersmith type of superstructure. So basically it is divided into three parts. So as you can see that, so in case of such structures, you have the main important is you are internal spine, that is nothing but your main spine that would be come into picture. Then again, you would be having the transverse members, so which is where your complete deck is supported on this particular transverse ribs, we can call, or wings, synonymously you can use those terms. So basically your spine integrally is longitudinally post tension, and your whatever the ribs are there, so that are your transversely post tension wings you call. So basically these are integrally connected to perform as a complete uniform structure, or at the end a complete uniform composite section, you can say. So coming to the major philosophy of load mechanism in case of spine beam. So basically it is constructed for the longitudinal action. So in case you have a longitudinal bending, shear force as well as torsion, that could be purely bear by the spine itself. So that could again be a major consideration in case of your longitudinal analysis with respect to your spine. So if you talk about the general span configuration for the longitudinal span, so it ranges from 30 to 40 meter as far now that is being adopted. And coming to the transverse wings, so mostly they are ranging from 6 meter to 12 meter on the either side, the width of the rib. So total constituting a structure in case of, you know, in case other from the your traditional box culvert. So it is quite a wide, or you can say two times than that of your normal box structures. So it need almost constitute a wider range, wider width of your box. So coming next. Yeah. So coming to the modeling philosophy. So in this case, I have just considered in the coming slides the example problem. So the, where the span is 40 meter, which is curved in plan, which is almost radius is of 450 meter. So for this 40 meter span, the width of spine is being considered, width of wing being considered is 7.5 meter on the either sides for the blind beam models. So for such structures, so the line beam model adoption would adequately reflect the behavior of the superstructure, the bending in the longitudinal direction. Okay. Then again, talking about this line beam models formulation into the program. So basically you can divide those particular section, line section, which your line model which you are going to adopt into two parts. So basically the section one would be constituting your main central spine, having your properties of the spine. Then in the section two, you can just constitute a spine beam and overhang which is constituted on the either side. So that would be again, would be according to the clause of 7.6.1.2 as per IRC 112 for the effective width consideration. So modeling a central spine and with the overhang could be adequately reflect the behavior of for the such structures with respect to your line beam models. So coming next, yeah. So coming to the major important definitions where engineer find critical to define the arbitrary sections, as you can say. So, so because the evolving of technology which today which involves with the spine and wing construction, so that is quite a typical wide span you have in the transverse direction. So you just need to model the sections to capture all your section properties very effectively. So with the line beam model, you can very easily capture the longitudinal effect. So to, for modeling such sections, can very easily use with the inbuilt property or inbuilt model in the section property calculator, with the section property calculator, which is inbuilt in MIDAS. So basically, so sections would be directly generated. So any arbitrary section could be generated and the properties would be calculated by the program. So you just need to save this particular file as an DXF. So if you are very well working with the AutoCAD, so that section property could be very well imported just by saving any of the arbitrary section of, such as in case of such a white box sections. So you just need to save that particular section and that could be directly imported to calculate all your properties. So basically this section property calculator tool is used to generate such properties. So it is basically calculating the properties using finite element method. So this could be the typical details for your longitudinal span for 40 meter. 40 meter span. Then coming to the next slide. Yeah, so this is the typical section which has been adopted in the typical line modeling for the spine. So as you can see, there is a wide transverse span of around 23.5 meter direction, and you have the along the longitudinal span as 40 meter, and the wings being of 7.45 meter on the either sides. So as you can see, this constitute of 8 meter central spine and 7 meter of your wings on the either sides. So the total length being of around 23.5 meter around. So as you can see, such sections is very typical than the normal traditional box culverts. So for defining such sections, you can very well use this inbuilt tool for calculating the section properties. So this is how the section is being defined into the program. So I'd be taking you through the demonstration part at the end of this presentation. So at this point, I will just let you know how these properties could be imported and calculated. Then coming to the next slide, this is typically the end section, midsection at the this particular location, midsection. Then you have the next one as your diaphragm section, which is at the end. So along the longitudinal span, you have these particular sections at around 2.8 meter span. And you can just look around. These are the wings which are being stressed at an interval of 2.8 meter distance. Okay, so this is your diaphragm section. Then coming next, typical configuration for your pre-stressed concrete spine would be as per this structural plan. So as you can check, this is the halfway plan for your deck slab for your wing consideration. Then this is at your deck level. So the transverse ribs are being spaced at a distance of 2.8 meter. So basically, this is a segmental construction. So basically, so that would be acted, or you can just divide those sections and you can very easily model this particular as an line element. So that we'll discuss in the demonstration part, how this could be modeled. Yeah, this is the typical modeling of your complete box girder bridge, that is your with the spine and wing construction arrangement. So we'll be looking at how this particular thing would be done with the MIDAS. Yeah, coming to the material properties definition. So for both concrete, your pre-stressing cables, and for your reinforcement, so we'll be adopting with the grade of M50, which is for your girder section, and the rebar information would be Fe500. So where we have the characteristic of cube concrete strength being 50 MPa, and then again with this for the reinforcing steel, then you'd be adopting with such properties definition for your as far as Young's modulus and coefficient of thermal expansion is concerned for the temperature grade, temperature load effect, that could also be defined in the program. So this is the typical definition into the program, how that could be defined. Then coming next, talking about the material properties for the pre-stressing cables. So generally we have, in this particular projects, we have adopted a type of cables as 19T15. So being a nominal area being this much, 26.6 centimeter square. So we have considered this UTS of cable for this one as 504.92 ton. So that could also be checked. So basically the two types of properties for the tendon have been adopted. And again, the modulus of elasticity for the pre-stressing cables have been checked into. Yeah, so coming to the next is your consideration of time dependent effect. So basically that is for your creep and shrinkage consideration. So time dependent material property would reflect your changes as your structural configuration and the load configuration is going to change with respect to your construction sequence. So that properties needs to be considered into the program. So that is quite a very difficult task when you are going to consider it separately. But in MIDAS, you can very well consider those particular properties in a single tab. So wherein you can very easily define with the creep and shrinkage properties with the prerequisite to codal provisions. So it will just reflect all your elastic and time dependent displacements. So you just need to provide your compressive strength, your relative humidity, the notional size, so we can very easily calculate all the creep coefficients and shrinkage strength values for your constructions, for your construction stage analysis. That would clearly reflect all your creep and shrinkage deformations for your time dependent effect evaluation. Then coming next would be your compressive strength. So in the compressive strength, you'd be again defining the second time dependent material property, that would be for consideration of compressive strength, since your modulus of velocity is going to reflect the variation of the change in the modulus of velocity with the time. So that you can very easily give with the codal requirement. Again, you can just specify the code and you can generate the particular modulus of velocity values. So for the As far as composite sections are considered, the difference in the compressive strength and the modulus of elasticity between the two parts, right? So in case of composite section, if you consider as spine and the internal the side transverse wings, so that difference would again be going to cause certain changes as the distortion of the internal spine. So you just need to account for those as well. So you can very easily reflect those particular changes into the program by giving the definition for the compressive strength. Then coming to the major important methodology, construction methodology of spine and wing construction. So basically it is, we'll just discuss one by one how the construction methodology works for this, both the bridges. So so basically it is mostly governed by the first factor which comes into account is by the site constraints. So it is basically due to lack of what you can say the availability of the land for or the divergence of traffic. So when you talk about most important roadways or the most important traffic ways which you need to build such elevated corridors. So in case there comes the major issue is with the site constraints. So at that particular point, adopting all your spacing would be a difficult task. So for that, you need to come over with the site constraints. So that is basically due to the availability of the land could also be another issue. So therefore, mostly in this such type of structures, the stage construction is being adopted. So which is obligatory and which is mostly a wide expanse, you can say. Then as we talk about the superstructure, the major superstructure is being constructed purely basically by your precast segmental constructions. So it is basically divided into two parts. So one would be your spine that is being casted at the very first. Then the second would be your cantilever slab, which is again supported with the ribs, right? So further, your spine beam is also being constructed with the segmental construction method. So the maximum length of the segment is being restricted to 3 meters for your running sections. So it would be went on to 2 meters for your diaphragm sections. So such restrictions is majorly because of the transportability issue, you can say. And obviously, it is also governed by the dead weight of the spine segment. Right, so that could be other things which needs to be looked into. So basically, the precast segments are erected with your overhead launching girder, which are again with the suspenders. So all the segments for single spans are suspended from your launching girder that you can see in the image below. So all the segments are stressed, or you can just say they are just stacked one by one with the launching girder systems. Then again, with the segment which are being casted, it could be lateral glyphed. So once all the segments are casted, it would again, just a minute. Yeah, so as compared to talking about the launching girder with the suspenders, so all the segments would be casted in single spans, then again would be further glued. So basically they are resting on a temporary external pre-stressing which is applied at the very once. So once the pre-stressing is done, operation is completed, mostly this is first of all at the initially they are externally pre-stressed so as to act as a continuous structure. Then again they are lowered and again they are on a temporary support package for your just for your spine beam. Then after the launching girders are moved forward for the further erections, so there the spine are joined one by one with the longitudinal pre-stressing completed. Okay, so for with the this particular within this particular span, the spine beams the wings are being casted at the site and they are being majorly transported at the site. So if you talk about the erection of the cantilever wings, so basically they are mostly after the complete pre-stressing of your spine. So again, they are held against the preliminary formwork which is installed for your launching of your wings. Then again, they are being lowered lower to the position with respect to the central spine arrangement, and after that they would be introduced with your longitudinal and vertical stretch joints when your transverse pre-stressing is being applied to the structure. Just a minute, yeah, some technical difficulties. Yeah, so coming down to transverse pre-stressing applications, so that would be again the temporary bearing which is rested, which would be again replaced with the permanent bearings once the transverse pre-stressing is completed. Then after that you would be having the serviceable loads, that is your crash pair would be applied and the crash bearing coat would be laid. So basically it is mostly a type of construction where you have mostly the so basically when your transverse pre-stressing is completed, so that could be again stitched with the help of the stitcher unit which is laid in between that. So that again would be with the age of that particular stitcher segment, you would be again having the age of that particular stitcher segment, and again the serviceable load should be acting. So at the end it would be promoting a sustainable solution for your balanced social and economical cost. So where is as compared to your normal box culvert where box bridges. And coming to the next slide. Yeah. So the major important in this particular type of construction is comes down to your loading sequence, which is being considered in the such type of constructions. So talking about this one by one, the sequence. So where the major considerations would be for your loads. So first I would like to tell you the longitudinal pre-stress to the spine would be considered at the age of 28 days. So days from your casting of spine would be considered from the 28 days. Then again you are being in the second stage would be having the wing load with the cast in situ concrete of that would be account for your 50th day that would be done. So when you are cast in situ concrete would have, after the completion of this, you will be having the pre-stress loads applied to the wings at the 60th day from the casting of your spine. This is being considered from the days from your casting of spine, and the serviceable loads would be again serviceable and the varying loads would be again acting at the 90th day. So this will be the loading sequence which would be again considering in the program. So basically we'll just try to see how this particular sequence would be simulated. Yeah, so coming next, further elaborating on this sequence. So if you just talk about the load applications and the section definition, the activation in the following steps. So if you in the first stage it would be having a dead load of spine which would be acting, that is the section one, that is we are considering here, we are just referring section one as spine and section two as wing. Okay, so you are just consideration the very first stage would be the dead load of the spine. The next would be the pre-stress, longitudinal pre-stress, which would be applied at the 20th day, that is for your internal spine. So all the cables would be stressed, the sequence would be adopted. Then again, there would be further duration for your short-term losses. So just when your pre-stressing is done, so there would be certain duration which would be left from your 28th day to your 50th day that could again be considered. Then the very fifth stage you can say is your casting of your precast wing loads and the cast in situ concrete at the 50th day that would be done in this stage. So basically we are just going to assume the precast wing load to be applied onto the directly onto the spine. So we are, for the longitudinal analysis, we are not concerned about the transverse members. So all the members at what we are considering would be through internal spine. Then you have the next stage duration for your long-term losses. So that would be again from the start of 50th day and ending at the 60th day. So that is 10 days duration for your when your precast transverse pre-stressing has been completed. Then again with this, the next stage, very next stage at the 60th, at the end of the 60th day, you will be having the complete transversely pre-stressed girders. So in this case, we are just going to assume the weight of the wings, which is being calculated from the either end, and that will be directly applied on the spine. So you no need to model those spines separately for the consideration of your dead load. Then again, you'll be having the long-term losses. So that would be again from the 60th to 90th day. And at the 8th stage, you'll be having all the serviceable expansions such as your crash barrier and the wearing coat. So those could be applied. And at the very final stage, you'll be having the long-term consideration. So basically for your creep and shrinkage effect study. So that will be from the 90th day to the infinity. So again, that would be again considered. So we'll just try to see with this particular sequence how we can formulate or simulate such type of sequence into the program. So just a minute, I'll just take you to the demonstration part. Yeah, so coming to the demonstration sequence, I will be just projecting with this program in how we can simulate these particular stages. So before that, so in this particular stage, we have considered with this particular pre-stress application. Yeah, for this, you will be having the types of cables to use are 19T15, so with the nominal area of this. So we have just considered the UTS for the cables as 504.92 ton. So in each spine section, we have considered a total 16 number of tendons. So that probably would be located in the web and the internal web sequence. So the jacking force which is applied at the end of your so that would be the jacking force would be applied at the end. So that basically cables are stretched from one end sequentially. So the force applied being would be 77.5% of the total UTS. So that should be the applied pre-stress into the program. So that would be also be looking into how those particular sequencing would be done. Yeah, coming to the major sequences of tendon pre-stressing, again, the import here also becomes important when it comes down to sequencing of the tendon. So if you just check, so your when your complete box girder is being casted at the zero day, if you assume at the zero day, so we'd be having the sequence as follows, where you will be able to, say, suppose this is, you have almost six cables over here. So which are at the internal spine, which is located. So this is being the, which are stressed at one point, and the two tendons, which is marked by this sixth one, so they are stressed at the later point. So particularly in the first stage, all these particular tendons would be stressed, and the side wavings in the second stage, and internally with the third stages, with the coming sequences, so one by one, the tendon would be stressed from one point to second point from both the ends. So there would be no eccentricity due to this particular stressing. So that is the reason why we are adopting that the two tendons would be stressed simultaneously from the either end. So we have just assumed that the tendons are all assumed to be stressed at one end. So it is basically one end jacking. Okay, so this would be the typical application into the program. So we have just considered the sequence accordingly. So if you just look around, the tendons would be stressed particularly on the 20th day after the casting of your complete box girder. Or we can just say if box girder has attained a minimum strength of 50 MPa. So whichever is latter, that could be also be considered into the program. So in the simulation, we have just assumed that coming back, yeah. So in the simulation, we have just assumed that the longitudinal pre-stressing is being done at the 28th day. So when your complete box girder is being erected, so at that point, the very first day, pre-stressing is completed with all the sequential, considering all the sequence. Yeah, so next is, this would be typical sequence that would be I'm projecting in the demonstration part. Coming down to temperature gradient load applications, so that is considered again as per the IRC. So for the temperature load effect, you would be converting all your complete box section into an equivalent eye girder section. So this could be the typical section which is being considered for your being converted eye section, idealized cross sections, where I could really be defining all your temperature gradient depths, temperature gradients depending upon your depth. So if you talk about the calculation of the effective depth at the top slab, so it's being a major wide span at the top. So you just need to divide with the depth. So accordingly, you can obtain such depths into the program for the depth of, again, for the soffit. And again, at the web, you have to calculate all the depth separately for the, since it's being a general section. So you just need to account for that. And again, with the major, the internal segments, again, you can directly check with the major configuration. So you just need to take consider accordingly. So talking about the IRC provisions for the application of the temperature load, so this could be the typical application as per the positive temperature differences, and for your reverse temperature differences that could be applied. So you just need to in manual interpolate the intermediate coordinates, and accordingly have to be inputted. Coming to the live load definition onto this particular structure, so we have considered the SV loading class A and class 70R to be taken with the combinations as per the IRC 6 provisions. So this particular, in this program, you can directly set the load models for all the types of vehicles. So now let me take you through the demonstration part where I'll be showing how this particular complete box structure O2D model with respect to your spines. So I'm just moving towards the demonstration part right now. So let me open this. So again, with this, we'll be again discussing about why the construction sequence is important in case of such types of structures. So let me take you through the basic modeling. So I would just like to show this sequence. So the very first slide, which we discussed about the section definition. So in such case, we have a very wide box span, right? So typically this is a 40 meter span of around, we have a little curvature of steep curvature of 450 meter. So it's being considered into the program. So this section has been modeled as a complete line element. So coming down to definition of the section, so you have this inbuilt tool in MIDAS, which we call as section property calculator, which stands for SPC as well. You can just, where the user just need to import the AutoCAD DXF file where you have defined any spine section or the wing section that could be very easily imported. So you can just set the unit systems over there. So let me project this particular tool over here. So very well, you can, in this particular tool, you can directly import this particular spine section into the program. So wherein you can just give the path for the AutoCAD DXF. So you can just check the section. Yeah, so let me check. So I can just set the unit system. So when you're trying to import the, any of the section, you have to be very ensure about the units when you are trying to import. So basically the unit system should be compatible with the AutoCAD and as well as your working environment in civil. So you can directly import those particular section into the program. Yeah, so such particular line model which could be directly imported into the program. Now what program does is it will calculate the properties, section properties as per the finite element. You just need to generate this particular section. And you just, after calculating the properties, you can directly very well export this particular section to MIDAS. So you have this option over here to generate the section. and to export this. So here you can directly export the section after calculation generating the section. All right, so I'll just typically show you into the program how that could be defined. So here you have the option to define those particular sections. So if you just go to properties, section properties, here you have this option to directly import such sections. So now herein you can directly give as an PSC value type, and you just have to select the PSC value type. So here the major consideration where it comes down to the factors or the definition of the sections is would be for your the area definitions and those particular properties that could be again imported from the SPC itself. You don't need to again define with this each and every parameter. So you can directly import the sections into this. So I'm just typically showing the defined sections over here into the program. So as you can check, so such typical spanning section you can directly import just by giving the path over here. So you can just see, you just need to import. Coming back to the definition again, so that particular properties could also be generated. I'm just talking about the generation of the spanning properties. So majorly I have just considered this as your composite section. This is being imported as composite general section, where I've just considered the major being as internal spine and the wings being the wing as an the cantilever slab which I have modeled over here, just to consider for your effective width as an box section. Okay, even with the diaphragm section also the same. So you can just define those particular directly from importing from the SPC. So you can very well define those accordingly. Yeah, so coming down to time dependent material properties definition, so you can very well consider those time dependent effect with the direct definition for the caudal provisions. So let me try to show you the all predefined property so you can just get an idea. So here you can set with the code provisions. So you just can just choose it from the national and the international codes. So you just need to provide with the compressive strength value, the relative humidity and the notional size. So just by importing this, you can very well generate all your creep shrinkage parameters. So all the creep coefficient values could be generated. And again, the shrinkage strengths could also be checked with. And the second time dependent property would be for your compressive strength definition. So particularly for your consideration of the change in modulus of velocity with the time. So that's again with the caudal respect you can consider it. Okay, so with that, now coming to the definition of your line model. So we can basically consider as far as the straight bridge or a curved bridge. So in this case I have considered a curved bridge of 40 meter span having a radius of 450 meter, which is which has been again with the same. So if you just look at the actual line model, so this would be typically my line model which would be defined. So it's just again you can very well use the CAD tracing tool to generate all your geometry over here. So I am just projecting the completed geometry just for the explanation to save time and moreover. So yeah, so this would be a typical geometry generation with respect to your sections. So basically this is your internal spine and these are your diaphragm sections which I have done. So as far as the change in the section again would be assigned accordingly. Then coming down is next would be your support definitions. So supports again I have simulated the bearings. So bearings are simulated using elastic links and the supports would have been defined. So the rigidity again I have considered using the master slave connection with the bottom support, that is your elastic link. Yeah, coming down next would be again, yeah, so this is your master slave connection over here and the elastic link simulation. So basically I have considered this as at this particular end I have considered a fixed fee condition. So it is basically guided along Y and Z direction in the either side and it is typically free at the other ends. So as you can see it is just restrained in the vertical direction for at the either support. Yeah, so now next would be a definition, just a minute. Yeah, So next definition would be for the construction sequence. So I would just like to, just a minute, everyone. Yeah, so talking about the construction sequences, so major would be, I will discuss about this. First of all, let me go back to the slides. So coming to the sequence information, so this would the sequence discussed as earlier. So first sequence, in the first stage, we have considered that in the complete first CS1 stage, the dead load of the span is being acted. That is, we have assumed the duration of a maturity of the concrete as 28 days. And the very next stage, we have just assumed that the pre-stressing is being activated. So here, the major important thing to understand or to look into would be the construction sequence and the pre-stressing sequence. That is quite important in case of your longitudinal analysis. Then we have just considered the short-term losses in between for your 28th death to 50th death. So again, we need to give the duration or simulate the duration with that respect. And the precast wing loads and the cast in situ concrete, which is activated at the 50th death. So basically, we have just considered the load of the wind fins, the what transverse wings at the age of 50th death that would be activated, and the long-term duration for between your 50th to 60th date. So coming back to the program, so as you can check, let me try to activate those stages. So I'm just activating the construction sequences over here. Okay, so in the first stage, as that can be observed, my longitudinal span is being casted. So we have just assumed that it has been casted at the age of 28 days. It has attained the maturity age of 28 days. And at the very first day, all the tendons are being stretched in the very first sequence. So let me try to show you the sequence with the construction stage definition. So typically, this is the definition into the program. So I've just considered with the superstructure element consideration, which has attained the age of 28 days. And at the very next day, the pre-stressing has been done. So in the similar stage, I have completed with the two major workforce, the major explanation of this. Yeah, so the definition of construction sequence is as follows. So let me try to first of all define with this sequence first. So with this, the spine erection and the pre-stressing, okay? So that is, we have activated the superstructural elements considering all your line elements at the age of 28 days. And in this stage, we have, when you're considering with the definition, so with the elemental definition, as for the structural configuration, we have just activated this superstructure elements. When we come down to support conditions, so we have defined all the supports and we have just assumed that it is being rested on the temporary bearings. So that again could be simulative further. And coming down to load, so we are in the very first stage. So we have just looked out up to this for as far as the element respect. Now when it comes down to load, so in the load, we have just activated the self-head. So in this case, the self-head would be for the spine, the central spine. Now next, the pre-stressing. Yeah, the pre-stressing is very important sequence which is being activated at the very first day. So the first day, it means that your concrete has already attained the 28 day strength. And to the very next day, the pre-stressing activity has been completed with the following sequences. So now this sequence has been already set. The pre-stressing group tendons have been grouped and I have just created the additional steps to generate in the very first day. In between, I have just converted this particular step by in the 6-hour interval. So the pre-stressing has been, the cables has been stressed one by one sequentially from the either end. So that I have simulated just by giving the additional steps values within the same construction stage. So this, as you can see, there are total 16 number of tendons. So that has been one by one, that has been pre-stressed at a specific interval, at a 6-hour interval, let's say. Okay. Okay. So this is all about this construction stage one, where you have just the dead load of the spine and the pre-stressing activity completed. Then again, next stage would be again, as we seen in the slides, it will be just consideration of your long-term effect, that would be from your 28th death to 58th death. So from that, you have only, I have just kept this particular stage with none of the elements or the boundary or the support activated. So basically the reason for consideration of this would be to settle down all your, the transfer of the pre-stress would be done at this particular duration, and again to cause certain losses. So I've just considered a nominal duration from the 28th death to 50th death. So if you just observe, we have already simulated this one day as an CS1. So again, the second stage became for your 19 days, that is from the consideration of the 28th death to your 50th death. Okay, so stage duration I have just entered here as 19 days to consider the time gap between first stage and second stage. Okay, so coming down to third stage, so the third stage typically would be your erection of all your launching arrangements for your transverse pre-stressing, which needs to be done. So here you just have the launcher weight, which would be activated. So the launcher where we have just activated. So let me go back and try to show you what are all the launching loads that have been assigned. So typically we have just considered, yeah, so if you just come down to base stage, yeah. So here the launching weight has been considered. So this is basically the elemental load which we have assumed throughout the span with respect to your central spine, the central launcher weight. So this is, we have just assumed this as 400 kilonewton, which is centrally supported. So this being important when it comes down to span by span construction, so this launcher weight is already acting when you are having the sequential casting or the sequential launching of your pre-stress segments. So that weight has to be already acted in the construction stages itself. So that has to be activated in the stages itself, nor in the service stages. So this is very important again. So we have just considered a central nodal load and your elemental load for your launching assembly system. That is in the launching stage. So it is being activated at this stage. Okay, so this is the one which we have preliminarily considered, or the formwork assembly which is need to be prepared for your transverse wing installations. So that we have assumed over here. So once the complete launching has been done, so now this transverse wing segment can be stationed in position with the help of the launching assembly. So in the mathematical simulation, we have just assumed that it is the complete load which is acting as an uniform load onto the line beam element. Yeah. So now coming down to next stage definition, that is after your launching of the segment. So we have just considered the one day duration for, we have just assumed that the load is being completely acting at once for your all your launching assembly that is being completed. Yeah, so coming next would be your wing liftings. So in the wing lifting, the major would be the activation of your cantilever slab as well as your wing slab, that is the dead load which you would be considering into the program. So typically if you observe, we have not modeled the transverse ribs over here to support your slab. So since transverse members would not be it would not be that accurate to model here into the line element whenever you're concerned with the longitudinal analysis, you just need to look into the weight, the dead weight which we can directly apply onto the spine. So we have just typically considered as an UDL. So typically whatever the calculation, the dead load of the weight would be there, so that would be again considered. So if you just wanted to see, yeah, so this is the typical dead load of the wings on the cantilever slab which is directly applied onto the central spine. So that is the value being 96.9 kilonewton, or you can so that is directly applied onto the spine. So this is how we are going to consider, rather than modeling your transverse members. So that would not have that effect when you are considering concern about the longitudinal analysis. So that is being applied as an uniformly distributed load onto the center spine. Yeah, so coming down to the again the launching system. Yeah, so the wing liftings. So here you can just check the cantilever spine that is being activated at this particular stage. So I just wanted to show you the load. So that is the reason why I went down to base stage. Even you can also check in the construction sequence also, that is the load which is acting. Yeah, so coming down next, after your wings has been erected in positions, so next stage would be your activation of the wings. So in the activation of the wings, we have just assumed that your cantilever slab, the dead weight of the cantilever slab is being removed at this particular stage. Okay, so it is just we are not going to concern about this dead weight. So it is being already deactivated at this particular stage. And again, coming down to next stage would be again removing all your launching assembly. That would be typically your cantilever or the launcher weight, which would be deactivated. When you are done with the complete transverse pre-stressing, then the launching lead would be deactivated, with further no would be considered for in the service stages. Then coming to the next stage would be the consideration of your serviceable loads. So you have the wearing coat and the crash barrier, that could be again installation, that could be again done. Then consideration of the long-term properties. Yeah, that is the last stage which we have considered, just for the long-term consideration of your creep and shrinkage effect study. Okay, so these things we have considered as one by one, the sequence of the pre-stressing and with respect to the launching loading sequence as the sequence progresses. So as you can just check again with the central span that is being activated, and again with the long-term losses, third would be again the launching assembly which would be activated, and with the same stage the transverse wings or the transverse slab would be activated, where we just consider the weight of ribs as an uniform load, and just the deactivation and the of the wing slab, and directly the support conditions. So here we have just considered the notional size of the member for the consideration of your composite section property. Since it's being a composite sections which we have considered, since your internal spine is there, and later at the service stage this particular wing would be activated. So we have just considered the sequence for your composite constructions as well. So this is, we have simulated using the constructions sequence definition for the composite stage. So here we have just activated the part one, that is your spine segment at this particular stage, and the second part, which is your slab segment, which is casted at the second stage, that is at the age of 28 days, we have just assumed. And the ratio, the notional size of the member which we have considered is 0.26. So we have to actually, you can directly specify the calculated value here itself, or you can directly auto update that as well. So that could also be done from over here for the definition of your sequence. Yeah, so coming down next would be, yeah, so this would be the typical sequence that would be considering for your longitudinal analysis. So coming down next, for your major loads we have considered with this the sequence. Then coming down to Lloyd load definition. Yeah. Before that, just like to take you through the tendon definition into the program. So typically we have just considered this particular tendon definition as already discussed. Typically it is 9, 12, T15 and 19, T15 which we have considered. So all the parameters we have just entered to calculate all your pre-stress losses, that's for your instantaneous losses and the long-term losses that we have considered. Then again, the cables have been entered accordingly. So the 16 number of cables which we have considered, so that have been modeled into the program in the spine segment. All right, So this is typically we have considered a total. So if you just talk about this, I just like to show you this. Yeah, so typically we have just considered all the that particular sequence of the pre-stressing by just defining with the groups. We have just made a tendon groups or the load group which we have sequentially activated with the duration, giving a pre-stress value of 1424 MPa, the stress value, which is again with the 77% of the total UTS which we have applied into the program. All right. So coming next, yeah. So the live load definition. Moving on to the live load definition, the major important definition onto the in case of your longitudinal, in any case of bridge, we have the live load important. So we have considered for three class of vehicles. Okay, so the three class of vehicle we have again just let me take you through this. Just a minute. Yeah, so the coming to the live load definition, yeah, is this yeah, so live load definition, so you have just considered the live load. Just a minute, let me try to show you the live load definition. Yeah, so we have considered a total three number of vehicles. So basically the SV70R and the class A vehicle which we have considered. So typically the three class of vehicle which we have considered. So I would be talking about the transverse in the later part after the longitudinal analysis is completed. So I just try to show you the transverse definition over there. Yeah, so coming to the live load definition, we have considered three class of vehicles and respectively we have considered all the lanes, respective lanes and commutations on the program. So for to evaluate the critical effect onto the spine, so we have just considered with that. And the cases we have found with the moving load cases, for that we have considered the critical combination of class 70R with the class A to evaluate onto the main structure. Okay, so if you just check with this, so this is the typical live load definition when it comes down to combination. So that has been considered as per the IRCs. So let me try to analyze this particular bridge for the respective loading. And we'll just have a look how the construction sequence is going to affect when you are just going to consider it with without construction stages and when you are trying to evaluate with the construction stages, so that you can very easily evaluate such effect in the program. So talking about there have been few questions about the transverse. Yeah, so okay, so what I will do is let me complete with this type of complete structure and let me try to show you with the complete thing, and I will just move towards the transverse explanation. So right now we have just so if you just typically talk about the longitudinal analysis, so we have just considered this as your central spine. So we have not modeled any of the transverse rift to nor we have inputted any of the tendon in the transverse direction. So we are just basically considering about, we are just focusing about the longitudinal analysis in this part. Then in the later part, the second analysis which we will be considering is with the transverse analysis, where we would be again having the lanes in the traffic as in the transverse direction, and again the tendon definition in the transverse direction. So I will just move on to in the later part. So let me try to complete with this. So I have just considered a critical moving load cases to evaluate the worst condition for your vehicular load or your maximum cases. So for that I have just let's try to, yeah, so now this is completed. So now you can just check with the result interpretation. So here you can form the load combinations typically. So for your creep shrinkage, and you can just combine with the moving loads also. So that combination could also be very easily made. So here you can just switch on to this. Yeah, so you can just evaluate the effects. So if the if you just check, so we are just concerned about the construction sequence definition. So if you wanted to check at any point of time, so you can very well, you can just check with the results. So here you can just check with the dead load. So let me try to check. Yeah, so typically the reactions could be obtained. All right, so again, deformation could also be checked over here. So the for the central spine. Okay, so I'm just trying to check the deformation stage by stage. So accordingly, you can just check when you are having the different stage of loading. Accordingly, your deformation is going to change. All right, so you have different stages and the different loads which are being activated. So accordingly, those result interpretation could be made. All right, so even that could be again viewed as per your view part. So as you can check the maximum deformation at the central spine. Right, so even you can just go on with the definition of your stresses evaluation and the forces definition. So typically, this being a line model, so we are just concerned about the maximum bending moment and the typical when it comes down to composite section and when it is around a complete spine section. So those effect we need to arrive at. Okay, so these are some interpretation parts which you can do it with the result map, and the stresses again could be evaluated for typically for your central spine and your slab stresses that could be again checked using beam stresses diagram. Okay, so this is all about the construction sequence definition and your result interpretation as far as your longitudinal analysis is concerned. So typically, even you can evaluate the effect for your moving load as well. So that could also be checked using moving load part. So you can check with the maximum reaction for any typical moving load case which you have previously defined. So you can just give the key node at the support node which would be acting. And again, you can just check for the concurrent reaction as well. So let me try to select the support node. Okay. So yeah, typically you can just check with the critical load combination and for your moving load also, and you can even trace down the vehicle position onto your girder. So I have just considered, so program will automatically consider the vertical load and the eccentricity directly onto the spine. So basically the major consideration here is the design of the spine member, the internal spine member. So we have just assumed that the load is eccentric for the placement to the central spine. So typically we have considered the maximum conditions to evaluate the critical worst effect onto the structure. So talking about the design of this particular central spine, so you can very easily go with the design of this particular section also. So with that, you can use this PSC tab wherein you can directly set down the code. And with the code, the next step would be the definition of your typical parameters, the internal parameters for your ULS and the SLS conditions. So that could also be checked. Okay. Then again, you can just go on defining with the material. So you can just define the material properties. So you can just check on into this. So you can just select the code and you can just select the material for your both concrete as well as your slab. So that could be defined. Even the rebar could also be inputted. So I'm just trying to define only for the girder section, the central girder section. Okay. So now you can just give the design position to the program. So typically the design position and the output position would be with respect to your parameters which you need to evaluate. So this is typically you just need to tell the program how the each section you need to design with. So just typically you can just check with that. Yeah, so after that you can directly go on with the performing the design. Okay, so you can just hit on onto the perform design, so program will automatically perform the design. And after the design is performed, you can directly extract all your results to the Excel report. So let me try to directly project that particular report rather than just giving more time into it. So I'll just try to show you what are the major things in the report which could be tagged with. So let me try to project this. So this is the typical generated report over here. So this is the generated report. So wherein the PSC generated report for the single element. So I have already designed with that. So this would be typical design parameters that would be, again, you'd be getting. So this is the input information which we have considered as with respect to the CODAL requirement. So typically, so in case you have this construction stage loads, so we have the construction sequence for the pre-stressing also, those loads we have already activated in the stages itself. So those would be again considered here itself. So different stress checks would be considered by the program for the ULS and the SLS conditions. So for the positive moment and the negative moment, it will check. So program again will calculate the neutral axis depth and again accordingly will find out the maximum tension and compression reinforcement for that. So you can just check with that. So these are the various stress checks which program performs. So we can very easily interpret from the design report for your various stress checks. Okay, so even you can check for your bending resistance also, shear and the torsional resistance, as well as your the permissible stresses in the tendon could also be evaluated. Yeah, so talking about this, you can very easily get the losses for your tendon. So you can just evaluate the tendon losses also over here for the respective stages and the respective cables which you need to choose. So those could again be selected and directly click on apply. So we have just considered, even the pre-stress effect could also be evaluated in stages itself. So where you can directly check with the instantaneous losses as well as your time-dependent losses that could also be checked with. All right. So now next so this is all about your definition of your, or you can say with the longitudinal and a complete longitudinal analysis you can do with just considering with the section definitions along with the slabs which we have modeled for your consideration of your live load definition. So now moving on to the transverse analysis thing. So in the transverse analysis thing, let me just try to open. So I will just try to explain with the procedural part in the program how the things could be done for your transverse analysis. So basically, so for a single box girder, which is with the large, as we can see, width to span ratio, the traditional cross section of the single cell box girder. So in that case, it might lose efficiency because of your shear lag effect, the cross section distortion, as well as your transverse bending movements. So, but some literatures that we have studied so far is like, so the traditional box girder for such sections would not be the most structural or the economical structural form for this consideration. So the major thing involved in case of transverse analysis would be to reduce the dead load of the superstructure element and to improve your stress conditions. And okay, hence we need to improve the cross section shape. So typically the curved section, the parabolic section that is being adopted with respect to the vertical clearance, that is visually we adopt as 5.5. So so that is being built with the rimmed slab. So this has been practiced nowadays. So the rimmed slabs can be adopted to, that is the reason why we are just adopting to make the complete deck tab as thinner and to effectively reduce your transverse normal stress at the wherever you have the roots, haunches at the roots. So which is typically caused by the major loading, that is your dead load and the moving load onto the structure. And again, the transverse bending moment would be again governing with the dimensions of the transverse width box girder. All right, so accordingly we need to check into, so we need to basically evaluate the effect of using the plate elements or your solid elements that could be formulated. So with the typical line element, so the transverse effect would not be captured with that accurately. So typically we need to model the transverse sections using the either plate element or your solid modeling. So that could be also be done with the civil itself, or you can go with the advanced FEA tools, finite element tools. So basically you can go with the FEA or FX plus, that is all the user's choice. So typically I have considered a typical section for your transverse analysis as a plate element. I have just completely modeled the complete white section considering your rib section as in your plate element. So as you can just check. So this is the typical for your transverse analysis thing. So considering with the plate element itself. So as you can just check, for that you need to have input such as your static loads, which you can very well define. Here the major thing would be to evaluate the effect in the transverse direction and the transverse momentum due to dead load and the live load. So we have defined the live load in the transverse direction considering a typical, again, the critical combination. So we have majorly gone with the surface analysis. So in that case, we have just assigned the surface lens for the same. So for the 70R, we have defined in the transverse direction, the lens have been defined. And again, the load cases have been formed for the critical combination. Okay, all right. So again, with the class A loading also, we have found from the typical cross-sectional in the transverse direction. Now coming down to the tendon input definitions. So whenever your spine is being completely analyzed for your longitudinal consideration, now we have modeled this particular complete spine as a plate element to evaluate the effect at the particular joint location. So in practical cases, you have the stitcher segment over here. So which being a major consideration for the design to evaluate the cantilever movement, the maximum cantilever movement that is arising due to the eccentric load. So that we need to analyze and observe that would be captured using this plate modeling. So that is the reason why we have gone for the plate modeling. And coming down to the tendon input, so we have typically considered a straight tendon definition onto the slab. So if you just check, so this would be the typical definition of your tendon into the slab in the transverse direction we have considered. So the workaround we have just considering the dummy elements which we have used to input the tendons, and there's accordingly have been stressed with the sequence accordingly. So majorly we are just concerned to evaluate the effect in the transverse direction and to check about the stresses and the moment at the critical locations, say as your cantilever, root of your cantilever segment. So that's thing you can evaluate. So after this definition, you can just check with the dead load deformation and the live load deformation for the same. So we can just check with this. So basically, this is typically the FEA model which we have generated for a short span, just to need to consider for in the moving load and dead load confirmation. But as far as complete span is considered, we can very well go with the complete modeling of your curved span in order to evaluate the effect for the same. Okay, so now you can just check with the deformations on the either direction, so that could also be checked with, right? So now even the stress contours you can just check. Yeah, so this would be the typical deformations for your dead load. So I'm just possibly looking for the dead load deformations, so that is we obtained. Yeah, so now you can just check due to the dead load what could be the effect. Now you can also evaluate the stresses and the size. You can observe that the maximum deformations are coming to the cantilever slab. So now you can just check this. So the complete deformation is with respect to the spine consideration, right? Yeah, so this is would be the deformation which would be checking into whenever you are going for the dead load. Again, you can just check for the live load also to evaluate the effect into the yeah. So let's go back with this. Yeah, so to again this is for the dead load which we have seen for now. Now let me try to show you for the moving load also you can just check the critical moments which are coming onto the structure. So this is the deformations which would be seeing. Let me try to show you. Yeah, so now if we have evaluated or we have defined the tendons into the program, but you should be very careful since we have already defined this as an dummy element, so that would be one constraint over here. So since the losses would not be that is effectively captured with the use of the dummy elements, so you have to just go with the interpretation of the pre-stress load and the critical moments which could be checked for the typical cases that is for your the plate forces could also be checked just for the dead load and the live load definitions. Yeah, so you can just check with this all the stresses and the strains for your typically for your plate element. So you basically you just need to you are just concerned about the critical stage moment and the end moment which would be defined into the program, so that thing you can capture it into the program. Or a secondary option would be again you would be just taking this particular software into the either finite element, which is again a separate tool, and you can just completely model these things as a solid model also. Those things also could also be checked with. So it is just to majorly to evaluate all your stresses and the moments in the transverse direction due to transverse application of the load. So this is the just the procedure part which I have shown you to consider how the pre-stressing, how the tendon input and how the modeling input could be done. So but just be ensured with the tendon placement, so you just need to accordingly input those elements accordingly. Okay, all right, so this is the complete thing which we have considered or the look into. So here the major involvement will be to evaluate the effect considering the rib and the without rib, so that sequence would be evaluated and could be checked into. So yeah, so I would now be taking your questions one by one, so you can ask with respect to the complete modeling thing as well as any questions if you have. So I could be answering that those questions, so you can either raise your hand or you can just put it down into the question and answer tab. So I'll just discuss one by one. All right, so there are a few questions. Yeah, so it is the one question by Mr. Prithvi sir. So you have your model both spine and wing section as in single sections, means this analysis is performed only for the longitudinal design only. Yeah, so yeah, Mr. Prithvi, so this what we have considered is as we have already discussed in the slides. So for the longitudinal analysis, we won't be modeling the transverse members, so that is not at all required. So because your transverse effect would not be captured when you are trying to model the transverse members in case of your longitudinal analysis, so typically we have just modeled this as a single line element considering the top rib slab for the longitudinal analysis, where your effect could be very easily because your critical load would be designed is your moving load, so that we have assumed taking completely that onto the spine element. All right, so what if we don't define the elastic link? Yeah, so it is the second question by Mr. Tripathi. So So again, if you are not going to consider the bearing, again that would be have the simulation would be again the simply supported one, wherein you can directly model the support at the end locations, as you can see in the slides. So you can typically model those supports over here. So if you are going to ignore the bearings, ultimately you are not going to get any of the elastic link forces for your bearings, like when you are trying to simulate the bearings. So you can very easily get the elastic link forces for the design of your substructure. So that is the only difference which is going to cause. But if you are going to more take the bearings into consideration, again the stiffness of the bearing would be accounted for the same. Alright, next question is by Mr. Mohammed Nadim sir. Construction sequence explanation in MIDAS, so which is already being discussed. Okay, so again there would be again by the next question is how is the connection of the transverse wing made with the spine, please explain. So as typically explained, we are separately considering both the things with the longitudinal and the transverse analysis thing. So as the same answers goes again, no need to model your rib for your longitudinal analysis again. So typically you just consider that is in transverse analysis, where you would be considering completely modeling all your rib sections with the spine. Again, you can just evaluate the critical effects for the same, that is your cantilever moments could also be captured into the plate elements only with the beam element. So those effect could not be captured since it's being a very wide transverse span. So it is recommended to use go with the plate elements. So there is next question is by Manan Shah, that is when to do a transverse pre-stress. So the transverse pre-stressing is typically done whenever you have a completely activated, so completely the stage longitudinal pre-stressing has been done. So the stages as according that you have the spine beams which are being completely resting on the temporary bearings and the longitudinal pre-stressing is being done. But with that particular definition, we have just considered with the longitudinal sequence. But whenever your links are being lifted with the help of gannetry and which is being erected at a site, so at that point you have this pre-stressing which is applied to the wings. Okay, so that is probably after your sequencing. Let me try to show you. Yeah. So the transverse pre-stressing here we have not simulated. Rather, we have just considered the dead load of the slab. That is the dead load of your wings which we have considered over here. So if you just try to check, so this is the dead load both of slab and the wings which we have considered under the girder. So you no need to model separately for the separate wing tendons for the same. Okay, so all right. There is one more question by Manisha Zadhav. How did you calculate the notional size HS 0.075? So typically you can carry out this notional size manually also, or program will directly automatically take the notional size of the member considering the formulations that is adopted with the caudal respect. So it is 2 times the area time divided by the total perimeter. So it will give you the notional size which is H. So that you no need to assign it separately. Basically program will automatically consider this H as directly, but this H which is has been entered just with the nominal respect to calculate, just to calculate all your creep coefficient and shrinkage strain values. But later on with the section definition, you can directly use this change property option to manually update, automatically update all your notional size of the members. So program will automatically take care of that. You no need to separately calculate all this. So that is again with this with respect to the formulation which is being used with the caudal respect. Some of the codes use with the volume respect. So that is the another thing. So that thing, both the things, you can enter the notional size of the member. So again, there is one question. Please explain the longitudinal modeling. So in the longitudinal modeling, I'm just by Mohammed sir. So In the longitudinal modeling, we just tried to go back and try to explain the things here after. So in the longitudinal modeling, we have considered typically the spine section, which we have extruded in the longitudinal direction considering a curved span. Okay, we have just modeled this to evaluate the effect due to dead load and the moving load and the other erection loads typically with respect to the construction sequence. So in that longitudinal modeling specifically, can you elaborate me further how you want to be look into half the typical definition you want in case of longitudinal modeling? So that would be great. So coming down to next questions. So there are a few more questions. Does MIDAS have transverse analysis as per the effective width method? So basically I just wanted to clarify on this. For the transverse analysis, you can very well use this effective width parameter option, but specifically for the PSC sections, you can go with that could be defined. Next would be, can we get the presentation slides? Yes, sir. At the end, I will be sharing with this complete video tutorial. Then can we do this as grillage model or the shell beam where the slabs and the shell elements and the spine and the rim along the beam section? Yeah, so this Mr. Abhishek Das, I would just like to clarify. Yeah, you can even go with the grillage also. Typically, the major important thing in the longitudinal analysis is to evaluate. So there is not requirement as such as grillage, because we are just concerned about the central spine over here, and those loads we have already considered considering the critical span locations, critical transverse span positioning of the vehicle. So that is the reason why we are not going with the grillage thing. So because for the transverse effect, if you are going to go with the grillage, again the line element would not be the correct option to go with. But it is recommended to go with, again, with the plate element. So next question is by Mr. Abhishek Sharma. In the lane, it's for the transverse analysis, the live load is moving in the transverse direction, or different axial loads are placed at the multiple location in case of the transverse direction. So I would just like to clarify. So in the transverse direction, typically we have considered the surface analysis. So in case of surface analysis, what exactly it places is, it will place the patch loads onto the complete surface which we have assigned. So let me try to show you. So basically, this is not the influence analysis. This is completely a surface analysis. So this load would be placed at each and every node locations considering all your plate loads. And the worst effect could be again evaluated further. So coming to the next question by Mr. Kundu, are we modeling the wings as composite slab with the wing? So no, so we are not going to model the ribs over here, but yeah, the slab is we composite with the central spine we have just modeled. So that thing we have seen in the longitudinal analysis part. So typically by next question is by Mr. Mohammed sir, how did the segment variation due to construction stages? Yeah, so the variation of the segments would be again depending upon the segmental construction sequence which you would be model. So here I have just considered two segments itself only for the demonstration part. So typically you would be having the different widths along the longitudinal span. So those could be again activated further with the simulation of the construction stages itself by creating different groups for the different segments. So those things would be very easily done into the program. Yeah, so by Mr. Amir, the next question is by Mr. Amit. About the sections varying with the web and the bottom slab for the composite sections. Yeah, This is again the same question which I would be like to elaborate further. So where you can very easily go on with the changing with the, yeah, so depth of the webs along in the, probably you can, it's possibly it's very easy to generate it into AutoCAD itself. So you can very easily integrate all the sections at once in SPC, and you can very easily define all the section, export it into MIDAS itself. Yeah, so next question is by Mrs. Yashashri. How are they modeled, plate or something else? Typically, yeah, so what, so they are being modeled as a line element, basically. Okay, the central element, so all these particular elements, if you just observe, I have, this is just a rib segment which I have centrally considered, and whatever the slab segment which I have considered at the later point is just for the placement of the loads onto the spine itself. All right, so as you can just check into the this particular line model, so this could be your line model for your longitudinal analysis which I have considered. So this could be the end of this complete webinar. So if you have any further more questions, so you can mail me down all your questions at the below mail ID. So you can just take my mail ID. It would be akshay@midasit. So if you have any further questions, so you can just mail me down for any further assistance on this. So lastly, I would just like to thank everyone for attending this webinar. So thank you, everyone.